When life's tragedies bring you to rock bottom in your life, where do you turn for help? Stay tuned as our guest shares where she went. This is Time Out. I'm Patty Sandifer. I'd like to welcome you viewers, and today I'd like to welcome our guest, Diane Harper. Diane, we appreciate your coming here to be with us today. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I currently live in Denver, Colorado.
Okay.
And right now, for many years, I was in marketing. I graduated from Milo Academy in 1970.
And that's in Oregon?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
In Southern Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And then moved to Denver. I've lived in Denver many years now. In 2003, I was in a pretty serious tragic accident. And as a result, could not walk for almost a year. But I'm currently an apartment manager in Denver.
Okay. Well, you have been through a great loss. That is quite a heartbreak. And because of time constraints, I want to get right into that story.
Okay.
Can you tell me and viewers a little bit about this, where it all began?
Well, this story began in 1991.
Okay.
Where we were living in Beaverton, Oregon at the time, and I was a single mom of three children.
Mm-hmm.
And I was struggling, as all single moms mm-hmm. do, and a tragic event happened to my oldest daughter. She was 16. Her name was Heather.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a picture of her. She also went to Milo Academy.
Beautiful girl.
And she was kidnapped and went through a terrible trauma.
Oh.
And that sent her into wondering, where is God? How could a horrible thing happen to me like this?
Mm.
And so we went through that summer mm-hmm. of her going through a runaway time period.
Mm-hmm.
And so during this time, some people were telling me that I should give her the tough love, and there's different things that people tell you when you start mm-hmm. dealing with a rebellious teenager.
Mm-hmm.
I really didn't feel impressed to do that. I felt like she just needed to know all the more how much she was loved.
Mm-hmm.
And during the course of that summer, she made a lot of wrong choices, and this culminated in her death. She was murdered on September 10 of 1991. And as you can imagine, this is the worst kind of thing that can happen to any parent.
I can't imagine.
And when you suddenly become, it's like all of your barriers or anything that you have around yourself is completely stripped away.
Absolutely.
And these are some pictures of the Oregonian grieving
mm-hmm.
for a young
mm-hmm.
niece that was on the front page. Here's a picture, police hunt boyfriend and girls killing, and then a little map where her body was found lying, a picture of the man that they were hunting,
mm-hmm.
trying to find her. Suddenly, you're stripped raw, and you don't know what you're going to do. And you're on the front, and newspapers are coming around your door. It sends you into a completely crazy place.
Yeah,
and
you
your cognition,
deal with the grief, and then you've got people at your door. And
yes, it completely messes up your cognition. But thankfully, having a spiritual background, a church background, I knew where to turn. I had a strong sense of, I knew that God was with me, but I was in a very crazy place. And
mm-hmm.
how I found out about Heather's death, it was at 4 o'clock in the morning mm. when I was just sleeping soundly, and all at once I heard a doorbell ring, and my other two kids, who were 7 and 9 at the time,
mm-hmm.
were asleep. I went to the front door, and, you know, you don't just automatically open up your door at 4 in the morning. So I said, "Who is it?" And I heard a man's voice say, "Open up your window curtains, and you'll be able to see my badge." And he put his his coroner medical examiner badge in the, so I could
worst nightmare.
Right. So I knew that it was Heather, and I threw open the door and just said, "It's Heather, it's Heather. She's dead, isn't she? She's been killed. She's been killed." And he came in, and all I remember in that moment when you hear those words are, I was just pacing around and making some kind of a moaning sound, which was loud enough so that it awakened my other two children who were awake at the end of the hall. And they came into the living room at that point, and I had to try to sit them down and give them the details of what had happened to their sister. And then, fortunately, we had a neighbor who owned a security company. He would he came to the door, and he and his wife came over, and they helped us a lot in that moment. But we called my cousin, who was the, you know, the medical examiner said, "Who can I call that would be here with you so I wouldn't be there alone?" Yeah. And so my first cousin, it took him about 2 hours to get there. And so the medical examiner waited with me. Fortunately, my dealing with the authorities was a lot different than what a lot of parents of murdered children experience. But he came that morning, and I was kind of in the, my first reaction was, "Oh, this can't be her. There's, it, you know, it isn't very long before denial will set in a grief."
Right.
And so I asked him for the phone number. I said, "Well, this can't be Heather." And so I called the coroner's office, and the other coroner answered the phone, and he said, "Well, give me some identifying characteristics." And so I told him that, well, this girl has dishwater blonde hair, green eyes, she always bites her nails, and I gave him some details, and he went and came back and said, "This girl has all those identifying characteristics." So I knew that it was her. And so the first person I wanted to call was my dad. And my dad and stepmom lived in Phoenix, Arizona at the time. And it was about 7 o'clock or so by this time. And so I knew my dad would be up watching the Today Show, and I knew what their routine would be. So I called, and mom wasn't up yet. And I said to dad, I said, "Dad, I've got to tell you something terrible. There's no easy way to lead into this kind of a thing." I just said, "Dad, Heather has been killed." At that point, I didn't know she'd been murdered. The coroner told me she had been a victim in a stabbing. And so I didn't know she had been murdered. I just said, "Dad." And when I said Heather had been killed, at the other end of the line, I heard, all I could hear was the most terrible moaning sound that I had ever heard in my life. And in that moment, it was like I became a little girl again. And it just completely broke through to my core. And I just said, "Oh, Daddy, Daddy, can you come here? Can you come here? I need you so bad. I need you." And he said, "Well, we'll be right there." And there's something that I wanted to share with the viewers today in sharing this story is, one of my goals in sharing my testimony at all is to help people understand more about what Jesus actually has gone through for
them. Absolutely.
And we know now that the words that Jesus cried on the cross, "Abba," are the words in Hebrew that indicate when a little child is going to his daddy. And Jesus was so broken in that moment, exactly like I was in that moment, that I can't read some things in the Bible or some things. One of my favorite books is Desire of Ages in the Gethsemane chapter.
Beautiful.
That talks about how broken that Jesus was. And, you know, I know a lot more as a result of this grief about the kind of grief that Jesus went through. Well, one of the first things that you think about when you're a Christian parent, and with the struggle that Heather had been going through that summer, she'd gone through such a rebellious period, and my main thing was, about 2 weeks before she was killed, I had just in desperation called out to God one night and said, "God, I am willing to go through anything, just save my girl." I didn't know what actually that would mean, and I'll explain more later exactly how he did save her. But I said, "All I care about is Heather being saved. That's what I care about." And so
we want our kids in heaven with us.
That's right. We want our kids in heaven with us.
Yeah.
But God knew that. He knew that she was a troubled girl, and she had really been hurt by this trauma that had happened to her. That looking back now, mm-hmm. 18 years later, what kinds of traumas she might have gone through in her life, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes, I think she got the easy part. She's just laying there resting and waiting until mm-hmm. we're reunited.
Right.
But in that moment, I needed some assurance.
Yes.
That she was saved. And so the afternoon of that first day, mm-hmm. I got a call from a woman who, she told me her name. And
She didn't know her.
I knew her. I knew who she was. We weren't friends. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I went to the Beaverton Adventist Church, and she was a member at the McMinnville Church.
Oh,
and
okay.
she just said, and she knew me. I had sung at her church, and I used to do quite a bit of singing. And mm-hmm. She said, "I'm just calling to let you know that I know that your daughter is safe to say that she was saved." And I said, "Well, how do you know that?" And she said, at 1:30 in the morning, and that was exactly the time that Heather was attacked, she said that the Lord had awakened her out of bed and led her into her chair where she always had her devotions in her living room. And she said she woke up and she was so troubled that she went right in there, and her mind was just visions. She was just flashing different verses coming to her mind, and so she immediately started praying. She knew that someone was going through a serious trauma and that she was supposed to pray for someone. And so she just started claiming promises and praying, and this lasted for about 15 minutes. And at the end of that time, she was able to have peace about it. She got this overwhelming sense of peace. But during that time, it was a powerful, emotionally charged experience. And she sent me an email about it that when I'm doing mm-hmm. presentations, I mm-hmm. read. It's a little too lengthy mm-hmm. now. But so she told me that, and that was incredibly reassuring to me. But I remember being kind of confused about it. And then a little while after that, another woman called who said, I'm just calling. I don't know if you remember me, but my name is Mrs. Swisher, and she says, I remember in your grandfather's Sabbath school class. And I instantly remembered meeting her, mm-hmm. and she was a little blue-haired lady. She was so cute, and she seemed so frail, was the mental picture that I got. But what the voice that I heard on the end of the line was, I am a prayer warrior.
Yeah.
I am calling to let you know that your daughter is saved and the victory was won. And I said, well, why do you say that? And she said, many people don't know this, but the Lord has called me to a prayer ministry. And for many years, I've had a ministry where sometimes I get awakened during the night and I pray for people. And I was praying for her for 2 hours. Well, what it actually came down to is God awakened one person to pray for Heather while she was going through her struggle. And he awoke a second person to pray for my family and I, because she was praying between 4 and 6, which is the amount of time that it took for my cousin to get there.
Yeah.
And so I knew from that first day that God, I was overwhelmed with that, the timing mm-hmm. of those two things. Mm-hmm. And so right from the beginning, I had the assurance that Heather was saved. But that still didn't have anything to do with the grief that you go through.
No. Because we love them and we
yes.
want them to be with us.
Well, it's yeah. horrible.
Yeah.
You think about, well, you can't even imagine it.
No, I can't.
Yeah, you can't even imagine mm-hmm. it. And another thing that happened not too long after that was when we were going over to, well, we had to go over for the viewing the day before.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have enough time for me to really talk about that. But before the funeral, which was the following Sabbath, you know, one of the first things that you face when you're in a tragedy like mm-hmm. this, you have to make decisions about, you know, funeral home and expenses. And
right.
at the time, I was an older returning student. I was going to Portland Community College, and I was mm-hmm. on financial aid, and I had no resources mm-hmm. as a single mom. But that didn't enter my mind. I mean, it's the least of your worries. Mm-hmm. But before the funeral, the day before the funeral, a man from the funeral home called the house and said that he just wanted to call and let me know that the funeral was completely paid for. Yeah, it was just incredible. The combination, various people, they knew that I was struggling, and my cousin had talked to his church about the finances. And the combination of people donating money and the victims' compensation fund, they pay for funerals, combination of all that money came to about $2 or $3 over what the total cost was. And so God said, I'm not only meeting your financial needs, but it's just a little tiny bit over.
Just a little bit over.
And so the funeral was paid. And then as a result of that tragedy, Heather was very outgoing. She was very charismatic. She had a lot of friends. And she had met a lot of kids downtown who were, some were runaways. And one of her friends that she had gone to academy with called me about 2 weeks after she was killed and said he'd been evaluating his life as a result of her death, and he was wondering if we could have a Bible study. So I said, sure.
That's great.
He decided, he invited several of Heather's friends, their mutual friends, and I invited several kids who were runaways who, it was kind of a slash, you know, a support group slash Bible study, what we did at first. And so every Friday night for about 8 or 9 months, we had this Bible study at my house. And the kids, one of the young men that came made no bones about being an atheist. And, you know, it was, at first the kids were really concerned with where is Heather maybe now? So that was one of the first topics that we studied. My cousin conducted the Bible study part, and I would fix a light supper, and it was be more the mom for everybody. And one young man that was a close friend of Heather's, he actually was quite a bit older than her. She was 16 and he was 30. He just looked a lot younger. And during this time, when Heather had been running away, we had developed a pretty close relationship. And he realized as a result of coming over to the house that, I mean, it was a pretty functioning home. I mean, it wasn't like some abusive home that she was running away from. And so he would go out and try to encourage her to come back home. And so I had gotten to know him during this time. And he had an old heroin addiction that he had struggled with when he was young, and when Heather was killed, he relapsed. And I got word from her friends that he was going around getting drunk and had relapsed really bad. And so I, one night in October, when I was just really desperate for some peace of Heather, because you get, you can't even imagine what, you're never going to get to talk to them again, you're never going to, you, just the whole cutoff is unbearable. And I remembered that we had made a tape when she was young, starting from when she was in an infant seat. I made her first sounds and until she was about 2 and a half and talking really well. So I went and looked for that tape, got it out, and listened to it. It was really comforting, and I just thought randomly to myself, I wonder if there's anything on the other side of this tape. And so I turned it over, listened to it, and found out that it sounded like from about the time she was 6 years old or so until 12, she had randomly taken that tape out and made self-recordings. And some of them were songs when she was in Sabbath school that she had learned. The last songs on the tape, one of them was dedicated to me. One of them was dedicated to her sister and brother. Another one was dedicated to my mom and dad. And it was like just the perfect thing that
for the time
us in grief really needed to hear. And so I made copies of that tape and sent it to a bunch of people. And I thought, I really want Chris to hear this. I think this will help him. And so I was able to track him down. And when I gave him a copy of the tape, I just left it with him. And he called me a couple days later and he said, and I invited him to the Bible study. He said, I want to come to that Bible study. There was something in Heather's voice, something that I want to learn more about. And so he started attending our Bible study every week, and then he was baptized between Christmas and New Year's. And the changes that took place in him were just unbelievable. Mm-hmm. He just, yeah, he was kind of like, he considered himself a glam rocker, and he just, he was really cute, but he had, you know, he was a real stark person and had a lot of makeup and jewelry and was decked out, you know, so that with some people's standards, he would put some people off. Well, on his own accord, all of that just came off, and it was just in God's own timing. And then when he was baptized, he insisted on being baptized outside in the river, just like Jesus was. And so we're standing there, and when he came up out of that water, and there was just joy radiant from his face, I knew there was the first fruits of Heather's death. And that the thought that occurred to me that was amazing was, only God knows what's going to get through to each person's heart.
Yes.
And it was that tape in particular that led to his conversion and his wanting to know more about her.
Something she had done many years
before. The Holy Spirit had led her years before. He knew exactly what was going to happen in the progression of time. And the way that God was making good on Romans 8:28.
I love that.
Because I was completely claiming the verse that God will make all things work out together for those who love him and that are called according to his purpose.
Right.
I was baffled how I was claiming that promise, and I was baffled how could anything good come out of this.
Yeah.
And then when I started seeing how Heather's friends were changing, Chris was baptized. Three different kids decided that they were going to go back home. They said Heather had told them that they should go back home. So I had three different sets of parents call me and tell me that they were sorry that I had lost my daughter, but thank me for giving them back their child.
Oh,
and so I knew that it was pretty overwhelming, that I knew all along through that God was making good on that promise to Heather, not just to me, because her friendships were so important to her, and he was using her death to bring more of her friends. He first of all gave me assurance that she was going to be in heaven with us, but he was also going to bring more of her friends so that they were going to be with her in heaven too.
So through this tragedy, having God to go through it with you made all the difference in the world.
All of the difference in the world. The statistics are very high of parents of murdered children who come down with a fatal illness within 2 years of losing their children. Criminality statistics are very high among siblings. If you don't have a foundation, if you don't know that God is right there with you, many people commit suicide. It's devastating. So the importance of a foundation can't be emphasized enough.
Now, we're going to be having you come back again for a next program.
Yes.
And so lead us into that. What happened after that?
Well, in the first year after Heather's death, we had a lot of answers, but we had court things to go through, too.
Okay.
They arrested the offender in Vancouver a day and a half after Heather was killed. And, of course, we had extradition to go through. There were a lot of court proceedings to go through that process. And I was experiencing a lot of answered prayers and wonderful, hopeful things in connection with her friends. But on the other side, having to be in court with the offender who showed absolutely no remorse was unbelievable. It was a completely overwhelming experience.
Little anger?
More than a little. There were times, I can remember being in the courtroom where I would be sitting there, and watching him make jokes with some girls who had come. He was, you know, he could have been considered a good-looking young man, I guess, to some young teenagers. And so there were some girls who would come into the courtroom, and he'd be turning around, kind of flirting and joking and laughing and acting like there was something normal about life. And the rage that I felt in those moments, I can remember grabbing onto my chair, and I would be white-knuckled with cramped hands just to keep from attacking him. I hated him so much. It was such a consuming thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was overwhelming. And
we are going to talk about that more in the next program, but just if you had something to say to viewers right now about going through tragedy, what would you say to them is the most important thing to remember?
That God is always with you. He makes good on His promises. You might not have any idea of what the outcome of those promises can be. You're at the very bottom. And in that grief, sometimes it felt like a heart attack, like I was experiencing a heart attack. And His presence, I would be screaming and crying out, and His presence would come and fill the room. So he will be there. You don't always understand it, but He absolutely will be there, and His promises are true, and He answers His promises.
And He will make all things good, even about situations that you just can't even imagine.
Yes.
That He comes through. And next time we're going to be talking a little bit more about the gentleman who was the offender.
Yes.
And forgiveness.
Yes.
And you're going to tell us about how forgiveness played into all of this.
And forgiveness is huge for all of us. It's such a universal topic. We all come, even if we come from a Christian home, we have dysfunctions. Mm-hmm. And we have things that hurt us in our past as well as in our everyday that happens. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness is a state of mind. It's not a choice. I view it as a mandate. And I'll be talking about that. But God wants us to be clean and whole. And if we harbor an unforgiving spirit, His Holy Spirit cannot work within us.
Yeah, well, we're looking forward to that. And I just appreciate your being here with us today. What a horrible situation. And I, like I said, I just can't even imagine it. As I heard the story, it was very painful for me to hear what you went through. But it is so reassuring to see how God holds you up through
these times.
And I just thank you for being here. And viewers, I just want to thank you for being here. This is such an important thing to talk about, because the world doesn't offer this peace that comes from God. And I just pray that between now and next time that you will take time out to pray. Prayer is powerful. Take time out to pray. Pray for those around you who are going through hard times, and just pray that God will give you the heart to forgive, and that He will help you go through the times of trial that you just can't imagine. Thank you for being with us. We'll see you next time.